Thank you very much. So first, I want to thank the organizing committee for the invitation and for all the obvious hard work they put in organizing this meeting. So this will be the second lecture in the lecture series with Christophe and myself. Today's lecture will be broken up into two halves. The first half, I'll be showing you some applications of the theorems that Christophe presented in the first lecture. He stated two theorems by KKL, and we'll give an application of each of them to so-called sharp thresholds. Sharp thresholds was mentioned a number of times in Vincent's course and also in Hugo's lecture exercise session. So that'll be in the first half. The second half, we're going to move into the mathematical setup that we need to first prove the theorems that Christophe mentioned in the first lecture, and that will be central to all the remaining lectures, which is the Fourier analysis on the hypercube. So the first so-called monotone functions were discussed earlier, but let me just remind you of these. So sometimes I'll call these monotone. Sometimes I'll call these increasing. So I should write a little bigger. I'll increase the size and tell me then if it's big enough. So the first thing to define monotone is we need a so-called partial order on the configurations, and we say omega is less than or equal to omega tilde. These are two sequences. If they are ordered coordinate-wise. So basically, this is a larger configuration than this. If it's obtained from this, and then you change some zeros to ones. So you just lift some of the zeros to ones. And then if we have a function, so often we'll be mapping into 0, 1, or into minus 1. And this will be called monotone if we have this inequality whenever omega is less than or equal to omega tilde. So all of the Boolean functions that we've seen so far are monotone except for parity. In Christophe's first lecture, the iterated majority, all the examples were monotone except the parity function. And what often happens, what we want to do is, if f is mapping into 0, 1, we can often, f will often be the indicator of some increasing event A. For example, A might be the crossings in percolation. And what was suggested in a number of the lectures you already saw is that if we look at the probability of A under the product measure P, so you'll recall in the first lecture, this is defined as the probability measure, where every coordinate is 1 or 0, 1 with probability P and 0 with probability 1 minus P, that this is going to be increasing, and often it might have a very sharp threshold. So the picture that you might have in mind is this function is very small, and then suddenly it pops up and becomes close to 1. This behavior often happens. It doesn't, of course, always happen, because if A is the event that the first bit is 1, then, of course, the function will simply be linear. But that we hope, in lots of situations, will have such a sharp threshold. So Christophe defined influence in the first lecture. So this was, you recall that the influence of the ith bit on F was the probability, and he was, for the most part, dealing with the probability P1/2, where the bits come in with probability 1 or 0, each with probability 1/2. So he had P1/2 of the event that I is pivotal. And you recall that I is pivotal is exactly the event that when you change the bit at I, it changes whether the function is 0 or 1. And I can mention that this is an event that only depends on the other variables. So basically, you look at all the other variables, and you see, do you already know if the event occurred or not? If you already know, then I is not pivotal. If you don't know and need to look at I, then I is pivotal. And this is called the ith influence. But to understand the sharp threshold, we need to introduce what is called the influence at level P. I put a little P up here. And this is analogous, except we have the parameter P here. So this is the ith level influence. And these are exactly going to be the things that allow us to define the derivative of the function PP of A. And the key lemma for this is called the Margulis-Russo formula, and it'll explicitly give us the derivative of this with respect to P. So the derivative of PP of A with respect to P at the parameter P is exactly this finite sum, I equals 1 to N, of the ith influence at level P. That's why we need the influence at every value of P. This sum we'll sometimes call the total influence at level P. Okay, so this is basically just a two-line proof. So let me show you the a proof of this. So this proof is not, for some reason, this proof is not the one I think that usually appears in the book, in the books. On the other hand, this is, in fact, the proof that appeared in the original article by Russo. So we have these two quantities which are not defined, and I won't define them because I claim they're defined in the obvious way. So this P1 through PN simply means that the first coordinate is 1 with probability P1, second coordinate is 1 with probability P2, and the last one is 1 with probability PN. So it's a non-homogeneous product measure, and we can look at the probability of A under this measure. We also can look at the influence of the ith bit under that measure. I'm switching a little bit F. Here I have A. I want an A here. So this is basically the probability that I is pivotal when the probability measure using is P1 through PN. And somehow what happens is it's easier to do this because then it suffices to show that to look at partial derivatives, and so I claim that it simply suffices to show that the partial derivatives are here, because basically, then to compute the full derivative, if you think of this as a function of n variables, p1 through pn, you're basically looking at a directional derivative in the direction 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and so I should just dot the vector 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 with the gradient vector, and that's what you get by this. Or I will just claim it follows from elementary calculus that you just need to show this. Now, what's interesting when we have this thing, we're considering P2 through Pn fixed. What happens, interestingly, this function here ends up being linear in P1, as you'll see, and therefore everything will be easy to compute. So let's look at this. I'll abbreviate the P1 through Pn by P vector, and I can write this as the event that A happens, and I have to do this for every I. Of course, it suffices to show this just for the first bit. So we break up the probability in these two things. If we look at this thing here, that event that A occurs but the first bit is not pivotal, this is measurable with respect to all the other bits. If I tell you what all the other bits are, the second through the nth bit are, you can immediately tell me one. You can tell me that you can determine that one is not pivotal. And if one is not pivotal, you can also determine whether A occurs or not, if one's not pivotal. So determine if this event occurs. It only depends upon those. It's measured with respect to that, which implies does not depend on the first parameter P1. So this will just be a constant independent of P1 when all the other variables are fixed. And now we're going to look at this one, and we're going to see this is exactly P1 times this influence. And then, of course, it follows that the partial derivative looks like this. The easiest way to see that is to look at this event, which at first might look slightly complicated, and we look at it in a slightly different way. So the claim is that this is the same as the event that I is pivotal, intersected with the event that the first bit is 1. These are the same event, because if I were pivotal, that would mean, and it's very crucial here that F is monotone. I didn't state this here. Hopefully that was clear. We're in the monotone situation. So if I happens to be, if one is pivotal, then if it happened to have turned out to be 1, then the event A will occur. So this implies that. And similarly, if 1 were pivotal and A occurred, it must have been because the first bit was 1. So this is the same as this. But now, this only depends upon the second through nth variables. This only depends on the first variable. So the probability of the two is the product of the probabilities. This is probability P1. And the probability that 1 is pivotal is exactly the influence, the influence of the first bit. So you end up seeing that this function is a constant plus P1 times some number, so the partial derivative is that number, and that gives us the proof of the Russo-Margulis, the Margulis-Russo formula. So it's quite elementary, but it's crucial for everything we do. Okay. So this relates the derivative of the thing. We want to show in certain situations we have a large threshold. So we're hoping the derivative will be large. This formula tells us the derivative in terms of this total influence. The total influence is something which was described, or Christophe described some results of in the first lecture. Now, he only described in the first lecture the case when p is a half. We have similar KKL holds for general P, and it's crucial that the KKL results hold for general P in order to be able to exploit the Russo formula. So let me state now the KKL results for general P. And the Christophe specified two versions, and I'll specify both of them here. The reason I want to specify both of them is we'll give an application, a quick application of both of them. And so we really want to have both. So the first one is the following. There exists a constant C such that for all functions F into 0, 1, and for any value of the parameter p you're interested in, there's some variable I whose influence is pretty large. There exists some I such that the ith influence at level p of our function is bigger than or equal to this constant times the variance of f, the variance with respect to the product measure P, times log n over n. So this is, Christophe stated this when P is a half, but this is true for any P. Note two things. Certainly the influential variable I might depend on which parameter P you're dealing with. The second fact which is crucial is this constant C does not depend upon P. This is a universal constant C. Okay. And we have a complete analog of the KKL2, which is as follows. There exists a constant C such that for all F as above, if we look at the total influence, which this thing here we could call IP, the sum of the influences, the total influence, then the total influence is bigger than or equal to C times, and this is all the same thing, for all P, the total influence at level P is bigger than C times the variance of F at level P times the logarithm of 1 over the maximal influence. So delta P equals the maximum over all I of the ith influence. So in particular, again, the C is universal. So it says exactly as Christophe described in the P is a half case, if for any level of P you're dealing with, if all the influences are very small, it forces the total influence to be very large. And again, it's not so hard to go from this statement to this statement. In the third lecture, you'll be getting a proof of this when p is a half, using the Fourier analysis that will come in the second part of the lecture. And this generalization when p is not a half will be covered in the exercises. So as a corollary of the first one, I'll state a theorem by Fried, Gutt, and Kalai, which is some general threshold result. That will be an application of this. And then after that, I'll, even though you've already seen two sketches of the proof that PC is a half, one in Vincent's first lecture and one in Hugo's exercise session, you can't see too much of a good thing. And so I will indicate a different method of proof. Again, it's based on obtaining a sharp threshold, but you apply this theorem here to obtain the sharp threshold rather than doing things with your hands, as Vincent described. Okay, so I do first the application of one. This is a theorem by Fried, Gutt, and Kalai. which basically says, it says in lots of situations, we're going to have exactly this type of sharp threshold, and it will even tell us how big the threshold is. And the answer will be that that place where the threshold is going, where it goes from small to big, is going to be at most of order 1 over log n. And that will, not so surprisingly, come from the log n that exists here. So the statement is there exists a constant c such that for all monotone events A having all influences the same for all p. So it says if you have a monotone function A where for every p, all the different variables have the influence. That's the assumption here. It might seem sort of strong. It's somewhat strong. But it doesn't mean you're dealing with the majority function. If there are a lot of things which are not completely symmetric but still have this type of symmetry. So I'll just make a comment that things symmetric things such as iterated majority. Iterated majority was described in the first lecture. So that's a situation where, in some sense, all the different variables are playing the same role. And so you'll have this fact that all the influences are the same. So the type of theorem I'm stating will apply in particular to the iterated majority function and any with this assumption. So there exists a C such that for all monotone A, having all the same influences, if at some value of P, the probability of A is at least epsilon, then you don't have to go so much beyond P to lift the probability up to 1 minus epsilon. Then, if we look at the probability at, I call that P1 instead, P1, and I'm going to add a little bit. I'm going to add log of 1 over 2 epsilon over log n. So I then look at the probability at this parameter, and this will already go make it past 1 minus epsilon. Now, of course, you should think of epsilon as very small, but you should, of course, think of n as enormous. So you think of your epsilon first as fixed, then your n is very big, and so this quantity would then be very small. So it says, once you've reached plus epsilon, just go a little bit further, and you'll surpass 1 minus epsilon. If you think of epsilon as completely fixed, like 1 over a million, it's sort of saying that, OK, once I reach epsilon, if I just go a little bit more, something of the order 1 over log n, I'll shoot past the 1 minus epsilon amount. Before doing the proof, let me just. I think this time I'll bring a few pieces of chalk with me. It's a long way back to this side of the room. So first, let me quickly tell you why it should be true. What is the idea? So the idea is that, well, we know the derivative of this function. Yes? Probably it should be appearing down here or up there. Let me look on the next slide. See, it will appear down here. Thanks. Thank you. So the derivative of this is the total influence, which we denote by I at level P. This is, of course, just the Russo-Margulis formula. Now, if we apply this one, and let's forget for the moment about this, It says there's some variable whose influence is of order log n over n. If they all have the same influence, that means the total influence would have to be at least log n. So this sort of suggests this is should be bigger than or equal to log n. Now, of course, it can't be bigger than log n because I can't have a derivative. I have a function that's always between 0 and 1. I can't have a function whose derivative is log n everywhere. It would blow up and go past 1. And the reason what's compensated is this term here. So this you should think of, this is more, this is basically, I'll just say in words, this is basically small if the function either has a very large probability or a very small probability. Then the variance is very small. So basically, the derivative will be very large about log n, except when this probability is already very small or very large. Then the derivative starts slowing down. So there's not any, there's no contradiction here. But anyway, this suggests that if the derivative is bigger than log n, in some sense, it should only take me about 1 over log n amount of time to lift myself very far. So this should be convincing as a heuristic of why this is true. So, and to do it is not very hard. You just you proceed as follows. It's easier to look at the derivative of the logarithm of the function. So what we'll do instead is we'll look at the derivative of the log of the probability of A. By doing this, we'll sort of take care of this small problem point. And in fact, let me, I just add one thing here. I hope people don't mind so much. This is more or less the minimum of the probability of A and 1 minus the probability of A. So the variance is up to a constant of 2, just the minimum of the probability that occurs or 1 minus the probability of occurs, and it will be useful since this is different by at most a factor of a half. I can think of this theorem as basically true even if I replace this by this. And this makes it just simpler when I go over here. So if we have the derivative here, we get 1 over the probability of A times the derivative of PP of A. And now, this is the same as 1 over PP of A times the total influence at level P. That's, of course, our Margulis-Russo formula. And now, here, it tells us we have each of the influences is bigger than this. All the influences are the same. So I end up getting that the total influence is at least C times log N times, let's assume for the moment that this one is smaller than that. So we end up getting, this is bigger than or equal to this times our constant C times log N times PP of A, which is C times log N. And this is fine as long as the derivative of PPA is less than or equal to a half. If it's not, what I did was not valid. But as long as PP of A is less than or equal to a half, if we think of the variance of F, instead of using that, using the minimum of these two, the minimum is PP of A. And so what I did is fine over here. And then these things cancel. And so it tells me that I get the derivative is order log n up to the point where it's a half. And so now what I'll just look at is I'll look at the point, I'll define P star to be P1, the point I started at, plus log of 1 over 2 epsilon over C log n. I'll look at this, and now what I'll show just basically because of the derivative, that if I look at the probability of A at this point, which is a little bit bigger, I already pass a half. So let me look at the logarithm at this slightly higher parameter minus the log of at the parameter I started with. And then just by the fundamental theorem of calculus, I can write this as an integral from P1 to P star. From P star of the derivative of the logarithm. We have a lower bound on the derivative of the logarithm, which is C log n, as long as we haven't passed a half. And so this will be bigger than or equal to C log n. And now everything cancels quite nicely. This is a constant. P star minus P1 is exactly this thing. The constant log n cancels with this. And this just turns out to be log of 1 over 2 epsilon. Now, this term here, at the point we started, we already surpassed epsilon. And so this piece here is bigger than epsilon. And then you basically can cancel the term log epsilon here and log and the log epsilon there. And we end up getting that at P star of A, the probability is bigger than or equal to a half. Just a quick check that follows from the previous one. So what we have done is we've gone from probability epsilon up to probability at least a half using this much extra space. And now now I won't do it. You can then easily go from 1 half to 1 minus epsilon using a similar type of argument, which is in the notes, which I won't do. OK, so that basically proves this result. With one comment, I won't bother to straighten it out. There's a slight mess up with the C here. John Francois asked me where the C came from. Basically, the C you want to use, I don't remember now in the notes if I have the C here or the C here, and that corresponds basically to 1 over this C. I'll leave it to you to straighten that. OK, so now what I would like to do is I want to give a quick outline in the remaining part of the first half of the fact theta of P is a half. And I want to basically do this by using this result here. So again, you've sort of seen some of this in the first lecture. I'll sort of outline it again. So I won't. This was sort of, I guess, describe. This first part was indicated, I think, in a strong way how that's done. So I won't repeat that part. This is basically based on RSW. And described explicitly in the notes. So just for here, I want to concentrate on why the critical. So this tells us the critical value is at least a half. I want to show you why it can't be any bigger. So I'll call it a theorem. So PC is a half. So let's assume that it's not. We know it's at least a half because we don't percolate at zero. So assume it's a little bit bigger. Assume that PC equals 1 half plus delta with delta positive. And we're going to get a, we'll end up getting a contradiction. So the event I want to look at is exactly the event was described in the first lectures. What I'd like to look at is the event Jn, which is the event. So if you want, we can think of both bond and triangle percolation have been described. I guess we can think for this. I'm going to draw a picture in a moment with dual paths. And as Vincent pointed out in the first lecture, it's somehow easier to deal with the triangular lattice because the dual picture is much nicer. I will think of white as my primal ones. I'm asking about whether the whites percolate, and the other color that I'm hoping, the dual color, will be the red. And the event Jn is going to be exactly this event that is a left to right crossing of a 2n by n box. So the first key lemma, and this I won't do, it's quite easy, and it's described in the notes and might be done in the exercises, which is basically once this probability gets big enough, you percolate. So it says that for any p, if the probability of Jn is bigger than 0.98, if for any p and any n, the probability this is bigger than 0.8, then at this value of p, we percolate. Then theta of p is positive. So it's interesting because it's a so-called finite criterion for percolation, that you somehow can detect that you percolate just by knowing that something occurs on a finite level. So the key fact to derive this from part two here is the following fact, which I'll explain why it's true. Fact, if I look at the maximum over all I correspond to the hexagons that are being painted black, white or red. If I look at the maximum over I, and the maximum over p, in 1/2 plus, I'll look just for technical reasons, up to delta over 2, of the influence at level p of the ith bit, this approaches 0 as n goes to infinity. So the fact says if you take any hexagon and any that uniformly, I take the maximum of all p, maximum of all bits of the influences, this goes to 0. Okay, why is this true? It's the same picture that we've seen before that Vincent and perhaps Christophe drew. Is this identifiable as a different color to you? Or not? Yes? No. Okay. My red has suddenly become blue. Hopefully, is that identifiable? This is the only picture I'll draw at this point. So next time I'll worry about having better colors. There's a white path here, continues here, and we have a blue path there separating it. So if you can't see the blue, you can imagine that. So this is what it means for this bit to be, this is what happens when this is pivotal. It means if it's on, there's a path. But if it's off, there can't be, there's not allowed to be a path, that, and that implies there must be a dual path separating this. Now, this is distance n, this is distance 2n. Let's say, without loss of generality, this person, this bit, is in the top half of the box. That means this distance from here to here is at least n over 2. So for any bit, for any hexagon I and for any p, this influence is at most the probability that there is a dual path from some point to distance n over 2 away. So this is at most the probability under P that there is a dual path from, say, the origin. We can view this as our origin to distance n away. To distance n over 2 away. Now, since we're dealing with dual paths, not the original paths, but the dual paths, the hexagons are on with probability 1 minus p and not p. So that means that this probability is at most if I were to replace p by a half. This probability would only get smaller. P is somewhere between a half and a half plus delta over 2. If I lower it to a half, this probability only gets bigger because I'm dealing with dual things. And so this is at most the probability that there's a path from the origin to distance n over 2 away. And this approach is 0 since theta of a half is 0. We don't percolate, and so the probability that you go n over 2 away, has to go to 0. We don't care about the rate. So this argument verifies this. So using this fact together with this statement, we're now going to apply this statement where f is the crossing probabilities. Tells us that the total influence, which we know is the derivative of the function by the Margulis-Russo formula, is going to be bigger than or equal to constant times the variance times the log of 1 over the maximum influence. The maximum influence by fact 1 is going to 0. Uniformly in P in the interval we're interested in, between a half and a half plus delta. So this delta P is going uniformly to 0. So our delta P goes to 0 uniformly in 0 in 1/2 plus delta over 2. So now we're basically done. We have, we're looking at the function, the probability of this event, Jn, its derivative with respect to P is the total influence by Russo's formula, which then becomes at least this. So this is bigger than or equal to a constant times the variance of the event at the parameter P times log of 1 over delta P. Delta P is going to 0. This is going to infinity. I don't even care what rate. It's going to infinity. So this is bigger than or equal to this for some an going to infinity. On the other hand, if we look at this function at a half, it's always bigger than or equal to some fixed constant c by RSW. So this function, it starts off reasonably large here, but its derivative gets larger and larger. It's bigger than or equal to the variance times a number going to infinity. As long as this function is not too close to 1 or 0, I get a bigger and bigger derivative. So at some point before, for large n, this is going to surpass the 0.98 number. Some point before here, it's going to surpass the 0.98 number. But once it does that, by the key lemma on the right side, we're percolating. And so before we get to 1/2 plus delta over 2 for large n, we'll surpass this and we'll percolate. And that contradicts the definition of the critical value. So then we apply key lemma key lemmas on the right side, and we obtain, as I said, a contradiction, because we'll end up percolating before the critical value. Okay, this idea of using, so that ends the proof, this idea of using these sharp thresholds of KKL, they used in a slightly different context, is due to Bolo, Bosch, and Riordan. So this is one method to do it, or the one Vincent mentioned where you show the derivative is large, not by using some of these results, but by using results concerning, by actually building with your hands the pivotals. So Vincent explained how with using RSW, you build lots of these with your hands. That also suffices, or you can use this method. So the point is to give an application of these. Okay. So that's the end of the first half. So if there are any questions, feel free to ask questions. Yes? Yeah, exactly. Right. So I didn't say a word about it. That's correct. So it's explained. One method is explained in the lecture notes. There's another method which might or might not be described in the exercises. But I didn't describe that at all. It's not so hard. I mean, I'm sure. I bet it's true for 0.9779. I mean, you need a number there to make the method work. So, I mean, in some sense, I could say, well, it's true for point. It's sort of no. Never mind that. You need some number there just to carry out the argument. But the 0.98 there I stated there is just completely arbitrary. I just took that as a sufficiently close number. So there's nothing special about the 0.98. Oh, yeah, what I was going to say, which was right, was, I mean, it's sort of stupid. If p is bigger than a half, that's also going to be true for large n anyway. But it's sort of meaningless because it sort of uses the fact that the critical value is a half. So, okay, so, yes? You mean the proof of the key lemma? One way, there's two different ways, well, there's probably lots of ways of doing it. Two ways, in my mind, the two ways that I know of doing it both use FKG. That would be one of the key things that you would use for it. Okay. So now we're going to go into the second part of the lecture, which is the Fourier analysis. Now, so you're going to see in the course three different methods to prove noise sensitivity. And the methods are all very different. But all of them are based on Fourier analysis. So the Fourier analysis I'm now going to present, it's absolutely crucial to all the methods that come after. So omega n, I guess, was already called. This is. So it turns out there's things like sines and cosines in our situation. And it turns out that representing things in these terms turns out to be an extremely useful way of doing it, of doing things. OK, so we start off with the space L2 of functions on omega n. This is just the set of functions f from omega n into the real numbers. Certainly, they include all of our Boolean functions, but they'll include any real-valued function. And the set of, and these will be endowed with an inner product, which is the usual inner product, where we'll denote it by f dot g. And this is nothing but the expected value of f times g, or if you wish. And now, in this stage, p is a half. The parameter p is a half. So this is going to be 1 over 2 to the n summed over all x1 through xn in omega n of f of x1 through xn, g of x1 through xn. This is the usual inner product on our space. We'll call that fg. And this thing here, it's a vector space, and it's a 2 to the n dimensional vector space. And basically, the reason it's a 2 to the n dimensional vector space is to describe your function, you have to tell me the function value at every point in omega n. And omega n has 2 to the n many points. So to specify the function, I basically need to specify it at each of those points. So this is a 2 to the n dimensional vector space. And of course, all vector spaces have bases. But it turns out there's a crucial basis that we want to use here to make everything work out very nicely. So there's a useful basis given by the monomials, so-called monomials, which I now describe. So if you give me any subset of the bits 1 through n, we define a function which I'll denote by chi s. It'll be a function on omega. And what it does is it simply, omega consists of plus and minus 1s. All I do is I multiply the bits together, but only those which belong to S. So I take the bits in S, and I multiply them together. And that's my function, omega S. It's a easy exercise that the chi s's are orthonormal. They all have length 1. They trivially have length 1 because they only take values plus and minus 1. And it's an extremely elementary exercise to make sure they're perpendicular to each other. Let me just, for clarification, s can be the empty set. And then this function is just identically equal to 1. Okay. Okay. So, and the number of chi s's are exactly what I needed them to be. There's, of course, 2 to the n subsets of 1 through n. And my vector space is dimension 2 to the n. So I have exactly a nice orthonormal basis for my space. You don't need any of this. I just mentioned it as a side, and I don't want to write it. There's a general theory of sort of four analysis on groups, which involve characters and things like this. These things I wrote down turn out to be what are called the characters in a more general setup. In this particular setup, they turn out to be fairly simple combinatorial objects. So I just mentioned that so you have heard that fact, but it's none of that will be needed. Okay, Now, since this is an orthonormal basis, I can take any function f and I can expand it in this basis. So I can take any function f and I can write this as a sum of all, over all the subsets of the inner product with chi s times chi s. This is exactly true. Since they're an orthonormal basis, I can always I just represent any function by taking the inner product with each of them times that function. Now, these numbers here, they're going to be crucial for everything we do. So this is, of course, nothing but the expected value of f times chi s. And these are going to be called, I will call this f hat of s, sort of like you have a Fourier coefficient in functions on the unit interval. You have sines and cosines and things like this. Basically, these chi s's are going to play a similar role to the cosines and sines you have in Fourier series. So this is simply the definition of f hat of s, and this will, I'll often call it the Fourier coefficient of S. There's one very simple Fourier coefficient I just point out, is that the, if you look at F hat of the empty set, well, what's that? That's simply expected value of F times chi the empty set. The chi empty set is the constant function 1, so it's simply the expected value of F. So this is one fact, call this fact one. Another fact, which will follow from this, just we know just by basically Pythagorean's theorem, we know that a vector in n dimensions, the length of it squared is the sum of the squares of its different coordinates. Of course, you have something completely analogous in situations like this, because you sort of have a Hilbert space. So basically, the total length of f will be the sum of the squares of these things. So we also have that the expected value of f squared is equal to the sum over all the subsets s, 1 through n, of f hat of s squared. F hat of s squared. So that immediately follows from this. If you don't immediately see it, you just take f squared, multiply it out, collect terms, and basically you'll get this. So you can think of this as a type of Pythagorean theorem. Okay. So, and in particular, if f is mapping into, this is true for any f, not only Boolean functions, it's general f, but in particular, if our function f is mapping into plus minus 1, what do we get? Well, then, of course, if f is mapping into plus minus 1, then, of course, f squared is 1, the left-hand side is 1, and so the right-hand side is 1. Now, the point of view that I want to give is that since these add up to 1, we can sort of think of the Boolean function f as giving a weight to the different subsets s. So one should think that a Boolean function f gives a weighting or probability to each subset S contained in 1 through N, where the weight of S is F hat of S squared. Okay, that's the key point. This Boolean function, it starts giving weights to the different subsets, and if the general function, these might not add up to 1, but I can still think of them as a weighting. I still can think of it as a weighting on each set S. In the particular case where I'm mapping into here, or more generally, when this term is 1, if you want, you can think of this thing happens to then be a probability measure. The weights it gives to the different S's is going to add up to 1. And it turns out, as we'll see in a moment, the noise sensitivity of our function F is going to be crucially related to the fact of where this weighting puts its weight. I'll write this all down later, but this weight is distributed on the different sets. Is it distributed on S's with large size or small size? And we're going to see this is going to be exactly equivalent to noise sensitivity or noise stability. And then once we have that, then you'll end up studying these issues of noise sensitivity or noise stability through these Fourier coefficients. But I'll describe that in more detail. So the following proposition, it's very elementary, but it's a proposition which exactly will now tell us why the Fourier coefficients are relative to the noise sensitivity concept, and also tells us why the basis we use, chi sub s, was a very intelligently chosen basis. We have the following proposition. So this was, of course, the key quantity in the probabilistic notion of noise sensitivity that Christophe described yesterday, once I subtract the mean, but at this point I won't. So this is the sum over all our S in 1 through N of F hat of S squared times 1 minus epsilon to the cardinality of S. Okay, so this is, I'll go through this slightly quickly. It's in the notes. It's not very hard. But the key point is you start seeing that, you know, for this term to be small, epsilon's very small. So if you want this to be small, that thing better be large. And so you want this thing to concentrate on the larger ones. Anyway, let's quickly prove this, I'll sketch it very quickly. What I do is I expand F into its Fourier series. So this is my function F. I now multiply it by the function F of omega epsilon. This gives me another sum. I sum now, of course, over a different index. I'll call it S prime. F hat of S prime. Chi S prime of omega epsilon. Okay? So it's exactly the product of these two terms. I now simply multiply through, pull the expected value inside. I end up getting a double sum over S and S prime. F hat of S, F hat of S prime times the expected value of chi s of omega, chi s prime of omega epsilon. And now the question is, what's happening? What are these expected values? Well, these are just products of omega over s. These are products of omega epsilon over s prime. You probably figure, okay, I don't see immediately, but if I had 3 minutes, I probably could do it. So let me just point out, the first thing is when S is not equal to S prime, since one of them will involve a bit, all the different bits are minus one or ones, each with probability a half. So the mean of any bit is zero. And if one of them has an extra bit, the other one doesn't, you'd expect that would sort of make the whole mean zero. And that's true, and that's actually more or less the same argument when you check that this is an orthonormal basis, which you should do. You can easily check at the same time that when S is not equal to S prime, this term here, maybe I will call this star, then star is equal to 0. So then we're only left with the diagonal term. So this means this whole quantity is simply the sum over s of f hat of s squared times the expected value of chi s of omega chi s of omega epsilon. Because all the other terms disappeared. Now, in order to get this proposition here, I'm simply hoping that this term here is equal to that. Well, if we look at this term, this is nothing but, if I just write things out, this is the expected value of, this is a product of the omega i's over s. This is a product over s of the omega epsilon i's. This simply turns out to be the product over I and s of omega I and, okay, omega I epsilon. For different i's, these are highly correlated. Remember, you got this from this by keeping that with probability 1 minus epsilon, and with probability epsilon replacing this by a new coin flip. So these are correlated, but for different i's, we have complete independence. So this is nothing but the product of the expected value. So this is going to be nothing but the expected value of omega I epsilon raised to the s. And now, basically, I'll just say it. I won't even write it down. It's basically what this expected value has to be exactly 1 minus epsilon. Why? This is chosen to be that with probability 1 minus epsilon. When that occurs, these terms are the same. You get a contribution of 1. That's your 1 minus epsilon. When you've decided to reflip this thing to be plus or minus 1, each with probability 1/2, that contribution of the mean is 0. So the correlation is exactly given by when this happened to be the same as that. And that occurred with probability 1 minus epsilon. And when it reflips, you get a mean of 0. So this thing is 1 minus epsilon. You have it raised to the s power. And so you have the proposition. Okay. Any questions? Okay, so I'm just going to rewrite that equation in a slightly different way. So corollary, the expected value of f of omega and f of omega epsilon minus the expected value of f squared. So remember, in the definition of noise sensitivity, you want to know how correlated these things. So of course, we have to subtract the mean squared to really capture the covariance. So if you look at that formula way down there, what you end up doing is you end up just getting the sum over s not equal to the empty set of f hat of s squared, 1 minus epsilon to the s. The reason being is the empty set contribution. What was the empty set contribution over on that last thing? Well, you have 1 minus epsilon to the 0 power. That's 1. So the empty set contribution was simply f hat of the empty set squared. But recall, f hat of the empty set is exactly the mean. Down there on board number 7, the empty set coefficient is the mean. So that first term exactly corresponds to the mean squared. So I brought this to the other side. Now I've expressed the thing we really want. very nicely in terms of the Fourier coefficients. So basically, this formula should tell you, yes, it's obvious to understand noise sensitivity. I want to know these Fourier coefficients. And it's even useful at this stage to introduce, even though it's just calling names to things we already have, to introduce the what's called the energy spectrum. So the energy spectrum is as follows. If we have, let me stick these into minus 1 and 1. It doesn't really matter. The energy spectrum of F, I call that E sub F. And it's simply going to be a mapping from 1 through N into the positive real numbers. And it's defined as follows. The energy spectrum of F at the number K is what I do is I sum up all the sets S whose size is K. And of course, the number of such S's here in this sum will be N choose K. There's, of course, N choose K sets of cardinally K. And I take F hat of S squared. So this is the definition of the energy spectrum of K. I sum up the Fourier coefficients at level K of the corresponding weights. It's the total weight of the sets S of size K. And this, of course, is defined. K can be anything from 1 up to N. This is what we call the spectrum. And you think of it as total weight of sets of size K. And this is also a nice way of writing it, because this formula here I can rewrite it as follows. So this formula exactly becomes that, because here I have 1 minus epsilon raised to the size of S. I can collect all the S's of the same size of a certain size K. So basically, I just break the sum, and I first take the S's of size 1, then the S's of size 2, then the S's of size 3, et cetera. When I take the S's of size 3, for example, for each of those, I get a contribution of 1 minus epsilon cubed. And then I have to sum up all the S's of size 3. And that would correspond to, just by definition, the energy spectrum at level 3. So this follows immediately from these two formulas. But what's nice about this, what it's telling you is, OK, to understand noise sensitivity, I thought I needed to know all about the Fourier coefficients. The answer is, no, you don't really. You need to know less information. That what's really crucial is the energy spectrum. So this implies the energy spectrum is crucial for understanding noise sensitivity. And there's a missing mean here. And basically, I'll state the result in a moment, but noise sensitivity sort of corresponds to the energy spectrum living mostly on large sets S. Because for noise sensitivity, I want this to be small. I have 1 minus epsilon to different powers. And this is, in a lot of cases, this might be sort of a type of probability measure. And what you would like is that this thing here would concentrate its weight on the larger k's. because that would bring this term down and not so much on the smaller K. So we even can draw a picture here of the energy spectrum. Here's one, here's two, here's N. And it's hard to say what it might look like in the notes. There are descriptions for some of these. Maybe the energy spectrum might look like that. And the crucial thing is how this weighting looks. So for the picture, and I'll state it in a moment, so for noise sensitivity, the picture of the spectrum very vaguely should sort of be maybe something like this. At the beginning, there's very little mass, and most of the mass is further away. That would correspond to noise sensitivity. I'll write the theorem in a minute. And noise stability, so noise stability would correspond to most of the mass sticking down here and not so much away. This is a vague picture. I'll now state precisely what I mean, but it's important to have that picture in mind. So now, mention the following proposition. This is in the paper by Benjamini, Kalai, and Schrum that Christophe spoke about. But let me just mention, this was the way I'm describing here. I'm calling it a proposition. It's just it's presented as just an elementary lemma, which it is. It's just so you set things up for the Fourier analysis for the hard work to come later. But let me state it now. Fn is noise sensitive if and only if. So I want this energy spectrum to be pushed away if and only if, for all values of k, the energy spectrum for the function Fn at k, which of course is nothing but the sum over all the S's of size k, I'm just recalling, of the Fourier coefficient of S squared. This approaches zero as n goes to infinity. Okay, so at every given level k, when you look at the total weight of level k, the total weight of all the sets of size k, that weight has to go to zero. And that has to be true for every k. So for all fixed k, the energy spectrum of the nth function at level k, so the energy spectrum of the nth function at k, this approaches zero when k is fixed as n goes to infinity. Okay, and so at this point, this is an elementary exercise. Basically, it follows from this. You express the noise sensitivity as this. If for small values of k, this doesn't have much weight, all the weight's on the larger k, but when k is real large, this is getting small. And conversely, I leave it, it's a elementary exercise. And Again, similarly, I leave it as an exercise. Based upon our key formula, there is a notion of stability. Fn is stable. The sequence is stable if, for every epsilon positive, there exists some k such that there's very little weight past k for all the functions, such that for any n you give me, for any function n you give me, if I look at the total weight I'll draw a picture of this f hat of s squared. This is simply m equals k to infinity of it's an f hat n here. The energy spectrum for fn at m, this is the same thing. This is smaller than epsilon. So okay, that might be a complicated formula, but basically what it says, the picture is if you give me any epsilon, I can find some fixed big number such that if you look at this energy spectrum here for Fn, no matter which one you look at, there, some of them might have a little weight past there, but most of the weight will be here and just a little bit, at most epsilon weight, past there. If you think of the energy spectrum as a probability measure in some sense, or a measure, which is a good way to think about it, this is really just saying they're tight in the sense of probability theory. Most of the mass, none of the mass is escaping to infinity, if that helps. Okay, so perhaps it's a lot to absorb in one time, but it's a good exercise to make sure you understand all these concepts by checking these things based upon that formula. Okay, so now we've related the noise density, noise sensitivity to the Fourier coefficients, but the first result that you'll see proved using these things is going to be KKL and not the BKS theorem. So what I want to do next is to show you quickly how the relationship of the spectrum with the notion of influence. So relation between spectrum and influence, and this is given by the following proposition. So assume at this point f is just mapping into 0, 1. Then, for any value of k, the influence of k for a function f can be expressed in terms of the Fourier coefficients. Basically, it's going to be 4 times the subset of s's where s contains k. I just sum up the s's which contain k of f hat of s squared. So I look at all the s's containing k, I sum up their weights, multiply by a factor of, an irrelevant factor of 4. Okay, so this expresses the influence of the kth bit. And we also have, for the total influence of f, this is the total influence, you end up getting the following formula. And these formulas are going to be crucial. These formulas are going to be crucial in understanding the proofs of the KKL result. So I claim the total influence is given by this. And this follows fairly immediately from these. If I take this formula and if I sum it over k, that would give me the total influence. So what happens when I sum this over k? I sum this over k on the outside. I can exchange the order of summation between s and k, bring the k inside, and then somehow I'm only summing up those where k belongs to s and their cardinality s many such k's. So you can quickly check when you change that, you end up getting the total influence. Okay, so this follows from that, and let me quickly give you the outline of the proof for the, this formula for the influence of level K. So it's useful to introduce what's called the discrete derivative, which I'll call delta K of F. And this is simply defined as delta K of F. It's a new function. And what it is I take F of omega, I take F of sigma K of omega, where sigma K of omega is omega flipped at K. So I simply take omega and flip its kth coordinate. That's what I call sigma K of omega. And I take the difference, F omega and F of sigma K, and I call this delta K of F. I think of it as some type of discrete derivative. And notice that this function takes values in 0, minus 1, and 1. These are just taking values 0 and 1. Either they're the same, and I get 0, or 1 is 1, and in the other is 0. And then I'll either get minus 1 or 1. OK. Now the influence of our function F is expressed very nicely in terms of this delta. It's nothing but the, it's basically just the L1 norm of delta K of F, or if you will, it's just the expected value of delta K of F, an absolute value. So why is the influence given by this? Well, what's happening here? If K were not pivotal, then changing the kth bit wouldn't have any effect. If K were not pivotal, changing the kth bit wouldn't have any effect, and I'd get a contribution of 0. Had K been pivotal, then by changing this, my function F would change either 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, and so this absolute value of that would be 1. So that's why the influence is exactly equal to the expected value of the absolute value of this. You get a contribution of 1 exactly when you're pivotal. OK? Now, this is the same as the expected value of delta k squared. OK, why is that? That's crucially using this fact. Of course, second moments and first moments usually are very far apart in probability theory. But here, the function is just taking values in 0, 1, and minus 1. I square any of those numbers, I get itself. So the first and second moments are exactly the same. But this is nice now. I have the expected value of a function squared. I can write this out as the in terms of the Fourier coefficients of this function. So this thing then becomes the expected value over S of the Fourier coefficient of this squared. That's just by our Pythagoras's theorem. So all I need to do is I have to be able to express these